So much. Well, hello. Hello and welcome to the Hanoi Philosophy Forum, guys. I'm really glad that you all are here. Thank you so much. Can I get just a show of hands from the audience? How many people here is it your first time coming to the Philosophy Forum tonight? Okay, wow. Oh, man, a lot of us. Wow, that's so great. Well, welcome. I'm really glad that you made it tonight. Super cool. I think we have a lot of stuff going on for us here tonight. This is by far the most people that have ever collaborated together on one of these philosophy forums, and I'm really glad that you all get to be a part of it. Okay, with all of that being said, I would like to introduce you to the wacky, the wild, and the wet world of the philosophy of drag. The first thing that I would like to do is let you know what we're going to be doing throughout the night. We have 10 really cool sections saved for you tonight. So first of all, we have this haiku and drawing contest. I think I've talked about that too much already. Next, we're going to have a talk on what drag is. Make sure that we're all coming at this from a basic understanding. We all at least know the terminology, what we're talking about when we're talking about drag. Then we're going to have a drag performance from Winnie, Wakanda, Washington. Winnie, I don't believe, is actually showing up. Oh, is she?
Yeah.
Downstairs. She's downstairs now. Okay, perfect. Yeah, so she'll be coming up in just a little while to grace us with her magical moves. I'm very excited for this. I'm very excited. Okay, after that, we are going to have a talk on the history of drag. It's actually interesting. If you try to look up the history of drag, there haven't been very many scholarly articles at all written on the history of drag. It seems like it's such a part of counterculture. It hasn't been embraced by academia at all. Putting this together actually took quite a lot of work. Is Meghan Cook in here? Meghan Cook, yeah. Meghan Cook did a great job. She's one of our researchers. Did a great job piecing this all together for us. Thank you very much, Meghan. Thank you. We're going to hear some art. We're going to look at some art and hear some poetry from Justin Broman. Justin, could you stand up for us, please? Thank you. Thank you very much, Justin. And then we're going to have a talk on whether or not drag should be considered a kind of gender rebellion or perhaps gender reinforcement if the intended goal of drag is actually backfiring in culture today. This is a common debate that's out there, and I think it's something that's important to talk about. After that, we're going to be having a talk on drag kids. I'm not sure if you've heard about this. 6, 7, 8, 9, 10-year-olds dressing up in drag, and there's a lot of debate online about the morals of this, about the ethics of bringing children into this world, and I'm excited to get to talk with you guys about this tonight, too. After that, we're going to have some artwork from Lara Hardie Stewart. She's given us maybe 5 or 6 pieces already for the forum. She's really great. She'll be talking to us a little bit about that. Then we have this beautiful panel here. We'll take a Q&A from our panel. You guys can ask any questions that you'd like. Be prepared that if the panelist doesn't like your question, that they might give you a little bit of shade for it. After that, to wrap things up, we're going to have a Skype session with Josh Roxas, who gave us this beautiful painting back here. Let us know a little bit about what was going on in his mind while he made this piece. Does that all sound good to everybody? That all sound good? Awesome! Awesome! I like that energy. Thank you, guys. Well, then, the first thing that I want to do, probably most important, is introduce our beautiful drag panel. Round of applause for our drag panel here, please. Thank you. Thank you very much, guys. Thank you so much for being here. If you could all just stand up when I say your name. AnnieTagonist, could you stand up for us, please? Annie, one big round of applause for Annie. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Zazazellia, could you stand up for us, please? Thank you, Zaz. Silver Saint Sinner. Ooh. Beautiful Silver. Winnie is downstairs right now. Could I get the Carter sisters to stand up for us, please? Thank you. Thank you. And Justin Broman, once again, big round of applause for Justin. Thank you. Thank you, Justin. Thank you. So throughout the night, if anything that I say, if I'm wrong about anything or if they have something special to chime in with, I'm just going to ask that they chime in with their thoughts. And as we go on, if you have any specific questions that really can't wait until the end, maybe you could even throw one or two to our panelists. Okay? You guys cozy over there? You all have drinks? You okay? Okay. Great. Awesome. Thank you, guys. Well, then, let's jump on into it. What is drag? I'd love to hear from anybody here, from the audience, letting us know, what is drag? Raise of hand from anybody. Yeah, please. You just have to kiss the microphone a little bit.
I have to kiss the microphone. Okay.
Yeah, thank you.
I always associate a bit of performance art with the image that comes to my mind when I think of what this question is. And generally in the opposite, dressed as in the opposite gender or than you were maybe assigned by society.
Cool. All right. Awesome. Yeah. So it's a kind of performance art, and you're dressing up in a gender that is different than the one that you were assigned, you said, by society, right? Okay. Yeah. Different. Maybe we'll hear from one more person, then we'll get into some of the more academic stuff. Anybody? Yeah. Maybe I can hear from one of our panelists. Would any of you like to give a quick definition of drag? Yeah. Please. Yeah. Please.
I'm sort of trying to come up with my own definition because I don't know very much about drag, which is funny. I just have my own personal experiences. I feel that it's a way to personify another aspect of yourself in a much more flamboyant way. And it just happens to be, for a lot of us, I'm doing good. oh my God, I hope this doesn't happen later on.
That's fine. All right, great. Yeah, thank you. Thank you. Yeah, Blake?
Since we talked last week, I've actually been wrestling with this question a whole lot, and I'm still not entirely sure if the answer that I'm giving is my actual answer or not. It might change over the next couple hours, but to me personally, we all kind of grow up generally in this binary of man-woman, and that's what we're kind of just assigned something. And to me, drag is any time that you, in some way, shape, or form, either defy that binary or exaggerate that binary to some kind of effect. Whether you're just trying to shock people or whether you're trying to teach people something, you're in some way playing with your gender in order to create a reaction in other people.
Excellent. Yeah, beautiful. I'm gonna leave this microphone with you all, and then if at any point you just want to chime in, you be my guest, please. All right, awesome. Well, thank you very much, guys. Thank you. Is it possible, actually, Claire and David, I'd love for the audience to get a full view of our panelists here. Maybe if we can just push the couch back a bit. Okay, yeah, something like that. So, yeah, it looks like there's an open chair here, and then I don't know what we're going to do with this couch, but maybe somebody can figure out something creative.
Just, like, take turns posing.
That's perfect. Thank you. Thank you, Blake. So from RuPaul, any RuPaul fans in the audience? Yeah, excellent. Great, great, great. What is RuPaul known for? RuPaul's Drag Race. Yeah, exactly right, exactly right. Yeah, so RuPaul says drag has given me an opportunity to leave myself when I didn't want to be me. So, a very simple definition of drag here. It's a performance that challenges gender norms. A performance that challenges gender norms. So, typically, of course, this is not all of the time. Typically, when we talk about drag, what we're talking about are cisgender gay men. Cisgender means that you have the gender that matches your biological birth gender. Gay men performing in women's clothing, makeup, accessories, and personality. Now, it's really important to say here that it's actually practiced by people of all sexes, of all genders, of all sexual identities, of all gender identities and sexual orientations. There are some people who are kind of drag conventionalists who believe that it's only gay men dressing up like women, but this is actually not the case, and I think that's an exciting thing that we get to explore here tonight, actually. So a lot of the time, drag performers, they use exaggerated characteristics, so exaggerated big eyebrows, big eyelashes, big lips, big shoulder pads, big everything. Larger than life. There's an important difference here between someone who's drag and someone who might just be like a transvestite, because they're actually not a person who is trying to emulate the other sex, but they dress like a drag performer. We'll talk about that a little bit more. So traditionally, the drag performance traditionally, drag performance has been associated with gay men and gay culture, but of course, this isn't always the case. Normally at a drag performance, it sounds like most of us have already been to one, which is great. Normally at a drag performance, as you probably know, there's lip syncing, sometimes there is real live singing, and sometimes there's dancing as well, and I think that we're going to get to see all of that tonight, which is pretty cool. So RuPaul, on this note about not exactly trying to emulate a person of the other sex, RuPaul once said, "I do not impersonate females. How many women do you know who wear 7-inch heels, 4-foot wigs, and skin-tight dresses? I don't dress like a woman. I dress like a drag queen." So the origin of the word drag, again, really all of drag history, not only is up for debate, but it's just very difficult to find. So we don't really know when the word drag started. RuPaul mentions that drag might have been first used from Shakespeare. It might have been from old theater. We know that there's at least evidence of it in print from about 1870, where it's referring to a man dressing as a woman. Some people say that in Shakespeare's day, if you look at like Lady Macbeth or any of these old plays, where the queen or any of the females were actually played by a man. Only men were allowed on the stage. No females were allowed on stage. So you had a man dressed as a girl. Dressed as a girl, D-R-A-G, drag. So some people say this is where the word comes from. Others say that it actually is referring to the long skirts that are being worn by drag performers, not wanting to show off their legs. They wear these very long skirts that drag across the floor. I've also heard that a lot of drag queens are cigarette smokers, so it's actually referring to dragging on the cigarette. And we just don't know which one of these is correct, right? It's all kind of hearsay. Yeah. So there are a lot of brand new words that might be thrown around tonight. This certainly isn't the full glossary. You can find a lot of glossaries online of drag terminology, but there are just a couple. So number one, red to death. Does anyone know the term red to death? Red to death? No? No? Yeah. Anybody? No? Okay, so being red to death, if you go to a drag show and let's say you're being overly drunk or let's say you're doing something slightly offensive, well, drag queens are really, really, really good at putting you in your place, at putting you down. So it's a way of making fun, making fun of a person. It is all in jest, it is all in fun, but oftentimes if you aren't prepared for it, it's actually going to get a little offensive. You might start crying. The word fish. Fishy is in reference to a female who, is in reference to a male who's dressing like a female where you don't actually know that it's a male wearing women's clothes and dressing like a male. You might say, oh, that girl is so fishy. Yeah, so some drag queens really look like drag queens. They love looking like drag queens. Other drag queens really want to look like a woman, and that's what we call fishy. I'm going to skip a few of these. Trans queens. Trans queens are people who are transgendered. So men who made a switch to being a woman and then still dresses like a woman in drag or dresses like a woman in drag. There are drag kings as well. Justin is one of our drag kings tonight. Generally is a woman, someone who's born a woman and then decides to dress up like a man in drag. There are also bio queens, also called faux queens or hyper women. Hyper women or bio queens. Oh, you look great. Hello. Thank you so much for coming tonight. Thank you so much. So these are women who are born female, who use drag as a way to hyper-feminize themselves. So maybe they're kind of tomboys in their day-to-day, and this is one opportunity that they have to become hyper-feminized. And now in response, I mean, similarly, on the opposite side of the coin, there are faux kings, and faux kings are birth men who are born male, and then they use drag to become hyper-masculine, okay? Any questions about these? We're all good there. Okay, cool. I hope you're taking notes. There will be a quiz. Okay, so thrown around in the drag community quite often is this nice little acronym. Charisma, uniqueness, nerve, and talent. If you've seen RuPaul's Drag Race, this is advice that's often given. Also one of the ways that you can judge one of the performers on their charisma, their uniqueness, their nerve, and their talent. If you haven't figured out the acronym by now, I'm gonna move on. Okay, so we're gonna move into our first small group discussion now. So this one is for all of you guys, and I'm gonna ask for the panel to respond after we get out of our small groups. But the question that we have is drag performance an art form? Is drag performance an art form? We'll take about 5, maybe 10 minutes for this one. We'll come on back, and then we're gonna have a talk on the history of drag performance. So, but we're gonna start here. Is drag performance an art form? I invite the panel, if you would, maybe scatter yourselves around if you can find an empty seat somewhere. Looks like we're actually pretty crammed in here. If you can, I might grab some extra seats so you can talk to some of the members. Any questions about the question? We're all good? Awesome, guys. All right, go for it. Thank you so much. Thank you. Okay. Hello, hello. Hello, hello. All right, guys. So, what do you all think? Does anybody think that drag performance does count as an art form? Yeah, raise your hands. Woo! Amazing. All right. And does anybody think that drag performance does not count as an art form? Oh, man. Yeah? One person. All right. Yeah, could you quickly maybe... could you, if you'd like, if you don't want the microphone in your face, that's fine. But could you tell us quickly, why do you think that drag performance is not an art form?
I don't know much about drag. That's my reason.
Well, that's pretty perfect timing. So this is your time to learn, my friend. So coming up next, we are going to have a spectacular performance by Winnie Wakanda Washington. Girl, get it. If I could ask before Winnie goes on, if I could ask that we just push this couch back a little bit would be great. Awesome. And Winnie, I could turn down some of the lights, but I don't have a spot for you. Is that all right? See, turning off the lights? Okay, let's give that a try.
Okay.
Maybe like that.
How's that? Is that all right? Andrew, how's the video? Video's showing up okay? Yeah, awesome, beautiful. Awesome, well, in that case, so... Oh, did the TV turn off? No, it's all right. So, before... I'm sorry to keep you waiting... Before we have Winnie actually give us the performance, I just think it's important to go over a little bit of drag show etiquette. Is somebody's cell phone going off? There's something from the TV? What's going on here? Sorry, guys. I have no idea what this is. What in the world? Oh, sorry. There we go. We got it. We got it. All right. So, before we get going, I just think that it's important to tell you a little bit about drag show etiquette. So it sounds like a lot of us have been to a drag show before, but particularly if this is your first time, or maybe if it was your first time and the last time you went, a lot of us don't really know the right way to engage with performers. So this is collected by two drag queens, William Belly and Big Mama Shlomo. They put out two different guides online, kind of combined them here into the most important ones. So number one, rule number one, please tip the queen to the best of your ability like a civilized human being. Please tip the queen. So I hope that we all recognize this is an art form, and like any art form, there's not a lot of money in this art form. The money is great. Also showing your appreciation. Let the girls know that you enjoy what they're doing so that they keep doing it, so that they keep doing it, okay? Awesome. That's number one. When you tip, please tip in the hand, not in the dress, not in the mouth. Please tip in the hand. If the performer wants you to tip somewhere other than the hand, they will make it very obvious to you. Drag queens are not very subtle people. If they want it some other way, they will let you know, okay? All right. Please don't ask for change when you give a tip. While you're watching, please be polite and enthusiastic. A couple of key words, maybe these are new to you. Maybe we can try them out, though. Maybe we'll do a little call and response. Okay, how's that, all right? Here we go, everybody. So you can repeat after me. Work!
Work!
Beautiful. Work it, girl!
Work it, girl!
Get it, girl!
Get it, girl!
Love it. So, please do not boo the drag queen. It maybe the drag queen will want you to boo, but this will be, again, made very, very clear, okay? The third rule? Please don't step in the area where the performer is performing. For tonight, it's this space. It might be cramped in the bar where you are. It might be cramped in this room, but it's important to keep this space sacred, okay? Rule number four, please take photos with the flash turned on. It's a lot easier to bring down the intensity of the image, but if the photo's too dark, it's kind of hard to bring it up, okay? And then the last one, please don't touch the queen most of the time. Again, if they want to be touched, they will make it quite clear, okay? All right, and consent is sexy, so if you do want to touch the queen, just ask. But, as was said multiple times, just stay away from the hair. It takes hours to put this on. Okay, can I maybe hear any other important rules that I missed, Winnie?
Boos are just applause from ghosts.
And with that, can I get one round of applause for Winnie Wakanda, Washington? Take it away.
Yeah, I can. Yeah, sorry. Hold on.
This is my fault. This is not Winnie's fault. This is my fault. Let me change this. Sorry. Give me 2 seconds. Give me 2 seconds.
Yeah, you're right. You're right. I'm wrong. I'm wrong. You're right. Oh, no. Sorry, guys.
We're coming.
Work it, girl.
Yeah.
Running back to the strip club, I'm never going back, never going back. No, you can't blame me. Never going back, never going back. They never take me. I've been enough with petty dudes. I've been enough with shitty dudes. I had a thing for dirty shoes since I was 10. Love dirty men alike. Ooh, better day than yesterday. Ooh, I just take it day by day. Ooh, yeah.
Amazing. Thank you so much, Winnie. Thank you so much. Thank you. One more round of applause for Winnie, Wakanda, Washington. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Oh, unbelievable. I love my job. This is so cool. Okay. I'm going to turn back on these lights now. Andrew, you might just want to check the videos we do. The lights being kind of down are pretty nice, though. That's all right. All right, well, thank you. So, oh, boy. So with all that, guys, now that we got a little bit of entertainment in, maybe we can, yeah, push this couch back a little bit. That'd be great. Now that we have some of this, thank you, Winnie. That was so much, that was so good. That was so good. Oh, man. I'd love to tell you guys a little bit about the history of drag. Maybe if Meghan Cook can stand up just one more time. Meghan, thank you so much for putting this together. She spent a long time putting all this together. This is from many different sources, all compiled together. She really did an excellent job for us. Now, with all of that, there's a little bit of a disclaimer that we need to put on the things that are being said here. It's pretty difficult to separate the history of drag from the history of men dressing as women for other kinds of purposes, right? So men dress as women in conventional theater. They dress as women as kind of gender-related fetishes. Whether or not this constitutes it being called drag, it's kind of a different question, right? So we don't really know. On top of this, I'm just going to shut this door for a second. It's pretty hard to find concrete information. So because drag is this kind of counterculture, it's not something that academia has really picked up on. There aren't really scholarly books that have been written about the history of drag, and that makes it pretty difficult. A lot of what we know, a lot of the things that are said about the history of drag, they're not backed up by academia, and they seem to actually just be passed on from person to person through some kind of oral tradition, which maybe is how we have a lot of our history, but it's so new. I mean, drag, the modern type of drag, has really blown up, while we're going to get into it, in the last couple of decades, and we still don't know much about that. So hopefully, with this much support, with this many people coming out to support a drag event, hopefully it's going to be taken a bit more seriously by academia moving forward. All right, so we can go back to some old theater and opera. So from very, very, very long ago, female characters were traditionally played by men. Females were not allowed on the stage. Characters often performed gender swaps in plays, meaning that it was actually a male character who was dressing like a woman, or perhaps it was a male actor dressing like a female character. Both of these happened. This was mostly used for comedic purposes. So there was a whole movement in the 19th century called pantomime dames, where it was men dressing as women. We have a picture of one over here. And it was really used for comedic effect, to get the audiences to be laughing and more into the story that way. There were two general kinds of these pantomime dames. So one of them, there were these older kind of matronly characters that were sympathetic to the audience. So if anybody's seen Mrs. Doubtfire, this is one kind of modern example of one of these pantomime dames, this old woman that's really relatable. Now, the second kind is kind of less flattering, and they're actually to be laughed at rather than laughed with. So oftentimes in theatrical productions of Cinderella, the stepsisters are played by men, and it just adds to the kind of mockery of these characters, right? Okay, so the oldest evidence that we have of there being some kind of cross-dressing on stage comes from old theater and old opera. Now, in America, we had minstrel shows that popped up in the 19th century. They started in France, they moved to America, and in America, they were actually far more lewd than what they had. Oh, whoa, let me get back here. I'm so sorry, guys. I was thinking about vaudeville, not minstrel shows. They did not start in France. Let me take that all back for a second. I'm sorry. So, minstrel shows, I hope that people know, were whenever a white person dresses up like a black person wearing blackface. They pretend to be very ignorant, they pretend to be very superstitious, and it's just a way to keep the suppression of blacks alive in American culture. Now, oftentimes, there might be females that are played in these minstrel shows, black females. Often these were also played by men, just another way to add to the mockery, add to the hilarity. Now, an important thing here for an upcoming debate that we're going to have is that this kind of minstrel show, it wasn't to encourage people to like black people, but it was to keep black people suppressed, right? To keep them oppressed in America. Then there was vaudeville. So this was in the late 19th century, so the late 1800s. Vaudeville, I'm sorry I did mix these up while I was speaking. So originally vaudeville, of course, is French. In France, it was this kind of variety entertainment. When it came to America, it was far more lewd. So the jokes that were being made were far more offensive, they were far more sexual. And there were many female impersonators who would perform comedy as a part of their act. So it was this big variety show. A lot of different performers, right? So we see here this vaudeville performer from the late 19th century. An important part about this is that only white males were allowed to perform in these vaudeville acts, cross-dressing. So there were no women dressing up like men. There were no blacks on the vaudeville stage. It was just white men. Anybody else, if they wanted to, they would be punished, right? So in the 1920s, and a lot of the history that was found is kind of based in America that we know. So women's suffrage began, and this flapper style started to become more and more popular. So women started cutting their hair short. They started wearing shorter skirts, things that were a bit more revealing, and they started taking on generally more androgynous styles and behaviors. So women wanting to pursue more traditionally male careers at this time, women who were smoking cigarettes, hanging out in jazz clubs, drinking more alcohol, women doing things that were traditionally considered to be male. And this was a kind of celebration, this affirmation of their new sexual and their democratic freedoms. So because of this, breast binding became very popular to reduce the size of females' busts. So they'd wrap up their breasts, make their breasts look as small as possible. And women also wore dresses that made their hips look more boyish than curvy. So it's just another way to decrease the femininity that's naturally found in their bodies, to kind of embrace the freedom that's been associated with masculinity for so long. Any questions about these so far? Yes, please. Maybe? Okay, yeah, we're going to have some open time for questions for our panelists moving on, but everybody's at least with me so far for this abridged history of drag performance. Okay, cool. Cool. So here we have what we believe to be a photo of the first drag king. So this was a vaudeville performer, And it's a female during this flapper era, dressed up in a tuxedo, having a very short haircut, like a man. Okay, then, in the early 20th centuries, this is the 1900s, modern drag emerged. So this is, it's celebrated, it's much more out in the open than it was. There was prohibition at the time. This is in America. They made alcohol illegal. So there were a lot of bars that started popping up that were underground, bars that were technically illegal, and the cops would raid them, the cops would go, but they did their best to make sure that they were kept secret. Now, these were bars that... The bars were illegal, so they also hosted kinds of performances that were generally not allowed in society, and drag performance was one of those types of performance. So there were a lot of drag performers that started performing in these bars that sprung up during the Prohibition. And it was during this time that the modern gay club scene found its roots. In World War II, we had many men who were segregated into same-sex regimes. And gay men found each other and migrated together to major cities after the war. So this picture, this is a real, it's been colorized after the taking, but this is a photograph of a drag performance that was done in one of the regimes during World War II. Okay. So in 1969, we have the Stonewall Riots. Many of us have probably heard of the Stonewall Riots before. Yeah, I see a lot of nodding heads. That's really good. So this was not the first riot of what would later be known as the LGBTQ movement, but this was a pretty major catalyst for the gay rights movement. So in the 1960s, this is in America. In the 1960s, it was still illegal to engage in any kind of homosexual act. And in fact, in New York, the Liquor Authority, they had the right to arrest you if you weren't wearing three or more articles of gender-appropriate clothing. And this isn't just an odd law that was on the books and never actually used. People were actually arrested for this. Gay bars were starting to pop up during this time, and they kind of acted as a place of refuge for the queer community. Police would go into these bars, they would raid them, and they would penalize the owners for allowing gays to come together in these bars, and they would shut down these bars for disorderly conduct. In 1966, there was a group of activists that overturned the regulations about these three gender-appropriate articles of clothing needing to be worn at all times. But these establishments, they were still harassed by the police. Okay, everybody with me? Good, good, good. So the Stonewall was a bar in Greenwich Village in New York City. And this bar was actually owned by people who were associated, who were into high crime at the time. And this bar, they bribed the police, even though they were a bar that was pandering mostly to gay guests. They bribed the police so that the police would just look the other way, so that they wouldn't be raided. They still would get raided occasionally, maybe just to keep their superior officers happy. But they were normally tipped off about the raid first. So they would bribe the police, and then the police would at least tell them before the police would come and raid their bar. Well, on June 28th, 1969, the Stonewall in Greenwich Village, it got raided without any kind of warning. There were 13 patrons and staff who were arrested in violation of this three articles dress code standard. There were female police officers who escorted suspected cross-dressers into the bathroom to check their sex, bring them into the bathroom, make sure that if they looked like a woman, that they actually were a woman. If they looked like a man, that they actually were a man. So there was a big crowd in the bar, of course, and the police were trying to break up this crowd, and the crowd just refused to disperse. As the police became more and more aggressive and were requiring more and more of these non-consensual searches of these individuals in the bar, there was a violence from the crowd, which then erupted into riots. Objects were thrown at the police. And these riots, they continued for 5 days in Greenwich Village in New York City. Now, a lot of people, I don't think this is a part of the story that's often told, but drag queens were actually pretty central to this movement, to these riots. We found this photo in our research. Right. Who's this? Anybody? Frankenfurter, thank you. Yes, this is Frankenfurter, Tim Curry. So in the late 20th century, things really started to turn around, you know. Now all over the world we have gay marriage being legalized in many countries around the world. So it's mostly in the West that we've seen this huge momentum forward. Also in the East, we've seen this huge momentum towards gay rights. Maybe anybody could correct me. I believe that Vietnam is one of the only countries in the world that's never made gay marriage illegal. Yeah, okay, great. Yeah, right. Don't like it, but they allow it, yeah. It's not a marriage that's recognized by the state, but at least you're allowed to get married. Yeah, great, great, great. And we also saw throughout the late 20th century, I think a lot of us were kind of alive for this time, that drag was incorporated in the mainstream media. Now, I'll actually want to stress one more time here that drag a drag performer is not necessarily gay. But for a very long time, drag and gay culture were really, really linked together. Not always the case, but it tends to be the case. So we see movies like Rocky Horror Picture Show, and also Divine, who is an actor in a lot of the John Waters films. And we even saw a lot of straight actors getting into drag in the late 1980s. So people like Dustin Hoffman in Tootsie. Did anybody see Tootsie here? Yeah? No? Okay. Yeah. Who's this? RuPaul, great, yeah. So RuPaul in the 1990s really, really, really took drag into the mainstream and is continuing to take drag into the mainstream. RuPaul says that drag will never be in the mainstream, that drag is necessarily a rebellion against the mainstream. So this is one way we can phrase it. I think that Ru might actually be a little bit upset with me for saying that it's taken into the mainstream, though. So RuPaul had a show, The RuPaul Show, and then in 2009, he began RuPaul's Drag Race, and they're moving in now to their 11th season of RuPaul's Drag Race. Keeps getting bigger and bigger and bigger. We have screenings of it here in Hanoi, these big public screenings, which are really, really fun to go to. Okay. Any questions about any of the kind of history that we talked about? It's all really disjointed, and I don't really know a lot more than what is being shown to you here. But yeah, maybe if I didn't make myself clear. Yeah, Brendan.
It's not a question, but RuPaul also has a podcast.
RuPaul also has a podcast. Awesome. Yeah, thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah.
Excellent. Yeah, please. So none that I can speak on. It sounds like someone back here can. RuPaul was actually asked about this on NPR not too long ago, and he expressed a bit of concern that a movement that's based so much on rebelling against the mainstream is being led in a big part by just one person right now. So it is a concern. It is a concern. And yes, of course, Sarah, maybe you could speak to this a little.
I think there is a growing misconception that drag is RuPaul and RuPaul is drag. So people should know that there are a lot of other big names like Lady Bunny,
yes,
Bianca Del Rio. Bianca Del Rio joined RuPaul's Drag Race, but she was there in the industry, almost as RuPaul. So yeah, a lot of not mainstream drag queens that are paving the way for more visibility of drag queens across the world. Yes.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
If
what is your name?
I may also add.
Oh, what is your name?
Pia.
Hi, Pia. Thank you very much. Yeah, please.
I think RuPaul is one type of drag, but there's so many aesthetics out there, and there's so many shows growing big and small. And something very different that you can think about is Dragula, which is the world's next drag super monster and not a supermodel. And that's where filth and glamour and horror play a big part. And you can see a lot of androgynous characters also there, which is something that's not featured a lot on RuPaul's Drag Race. So, yeah, I think there are many icons that are coming up or are there currently.
Excellent. Yeah, thank you very much. Yeah, and I'm pretty sure that there's a pretty big debate right now because RuPaul has said that he doesn't want to allow any post-op performers on his show, which I think is kind of a divide. But it just shows there are lots of different ways to do drag. And when we had dinner the other night, one of the nice things that I learned is how appreciative a lot of the drag performers are here for the diversity in the drag community. That we have drag kings, that we have what are called faux queens, that we have conventional drag queens here in this community. It's really great. If you haven't had a chance, seems like a lot of us have. If you haven't had a chance to go to some of these shows, I would really recommend it. Yeah, please.
This is the question to the panel. I've been really curious about this. In referring to the pronouns, when you are dressed up, do you want to be called she? And then when you're not dressed up, he? Or do you prefer to just be called she all the time? Because I know that this is a sensitive topic, and I was just wondering how to be courteous and respectful towards that.
Thank you.
I know that it kind of depends on the individual and their own experience and why they come into drag. So you'd really have to ask every single person personally is the unfortunate answer to that. I know for me personally, I was introduced as multiple women. I have multiple personas, and they all actually have different opinions on it. Like, one of them insists that she's a woman. One of them will insist that she's a woman, but will also acknowledge she has male genitalia. The other one will completely just derail the topic into animal genitalia. I don't know. I have a lot of fun with it. I don't know what you guys do.
Well, I think, there are a lot of trans queens out there, and with them, I think especially pronouns are very important to acknowledge. But for a lot of gay men, it doesn't really matter. Like, way before I did drag, all my friends kept calling me girl. They would say, hey, girl, how you doing? And I would say, I'm good, how you doing? You know, because it doesn't matter. You can call me he, you can call me she, you can call me Donald Trump on a bad hair day. Just call me something, you know. But if you're a trans person, your pronouns need to be really, 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 really respected. Anyone else?
I would like to add that usually, I mean, people aren't offended by the question. So if you ask, what is your pronoun? Totally fine to ask.
You have to kiss it.
Did everyone hear?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, awesome. Great. Yeah. Thank you so much, guys. Thank you very much. Yeah. And please do stick around. We're going to have a kind of lengthy, about 25-minute Q&A kind of to wrap up the meeting at the very end. Before we do that, though, we're going to take an opportunity to break up into small groups once again. And the question, I'm not sure why it's formatted like this. That's a little strange. But the question is, why are so many cultures around the world initially offended by gender non-conformativity? Yeah. So let's break up into small groups once again. If you didn't like the people that you were with, maybe you can stand up and move. That's allowed. That's fine. You can just make an excuse, say that you have to use the bathroom or something, and we'll come back in about 10 minutes, guys. Thank you. Thank you. Alrighty, guys. I'm so sorry to break up the conversations. I'm so sorry. I'm glad you guys are all getting into it, though. Was there anything pretty cool that came up in any of the groups that anybody would like to share? Maybe I can hear from just one person. Want to raise your hand? Tell us anything. Why do you think that in so many cultures, gender nonconformativity is banned? Anybody? No, we embrace the tangents a little bit too much. That's okay. Yeah, one? Yeah, please. Yeah, please.
What did we talk about? Like, everyone had so much to talk about. Well, oh, God. Blanking, of course. Well, we talked about how... Right. It's interesting how the conversation kind of dovetailed into the fetishization of Asian women and the the interesting binary that we put into, right? Asian women are seen as extremely feminine for some reason, whereas Asian... Oh, interesting. So if any one of you is on Tinder or any kind of dating app, Asian men and black women are the least popular on these dating apps because Asian men are considered too feminine and black women are considered too masculine. And I mean, you see the binary and the kind of definition of what it means to be feminine and masculine in this kind of discrimination is quite obvious.
Thank you. Thank you for sharing. Alrighty, guys. Well, I'd like to bring up Justin Broman to the stage. Is Justin here? Did she escape? Where did she go? I just told her. Yeah, come on. It's you. You're on. Come on. Yeah, round of applause for Justin Broman, please. Justin Broman. Am I allowed to say your real name? Yeah, okay. So this is Clara Lord. Woo! Clara Lord. And I imagine that you'll be telling us everything. I don't think that there's a need for any introduction. So I'm going to... Yeah.
Okay.
So how long have you been in Hanoi now, Claire?
4 years.
Claire's been in Hanoi for 4 years. I know Claire from poetry readings at Snug and from ClickSpace Open Mic. She's a phenomenal performer. You can look up her name, and she has a project that she's been working on for a few years, Face Conscious, which is encouraging free expression, however you choose to express yourself. Just encouraging free expression in any of its forms. And with that, I'll turn everything over to Claire. Thank you so much for doing this, Claire. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and thank you for having me here. As John said, yeah, I'm used to performing, and yet for some reason, as Justin, I'm suddenly back at square one and shy as I've ever been. And I don't know why. Okay. So it's like I've been sort of, you know, groomed to be a woman, and now I'm like, shoot, I gotta start being a man. Okay, so do I have a clicker? Okay, so I also, so my project Face Conscious is also a visual diary. So I'm going to be presenting some of my pieces I've done to do with drag. So this is the first one I want to talk about. This is not actually to do with drag, but this one is sort of where it sort of starts for me. This one is called A Weird Cage to Be In. And the reason for this is, you see the expression is not quite happy with, let's say, the hair and the Alice band. I was always a tomboy, and I love to wear dungarees. I love to, just to wear practical clothing. But I was put in this place where I was told, you know, to like pink and all these like girly things that had nothing to do with who I was as a person. So it's all very nice and pretty, bit of a weird cage to be in. This was in Indonesia. I went to a drag show, just sort of by chance, and I was so excited by the whole thing. And I actually have a little poem, so I'll start off with that. I still consider these a work in progress. This one I actually wrote today. I'll try to get this... I'll say it nice and slowly, so. This is my story, a fragment anyway. of the time I discovered drag one day. I heard of it, but didn't much know how exciting and thrilling could be their show. In Indonesia, at the end of the year, I mounted the stage in a club that was queer. They gave me a shot and then let me be, and the rest of the night, I was drunk, you see. I strutted the runway, though no one looked, and imagined my future, everyone hooked. But not as a woman, to be a man, kind of sexy, mustache, chest hair, and a tan. As I'd always wanted to dress that way, but felt shy, I'd be told to just go away. I do wear men's clothes and like to be manly, but people tell me to be a lot more girly. To be hardcore and flex my muscle, not sit on a bench giving my skirt a rustle. I want to be me, but society says no. But fuck that, here I am, giving you all a show. Self-expression is important, and I will never forget to be my real self in life, to live a life I won't regret. Thank you. So then this is 2.5 years later. Still doing face conscious, what? It couldn't have been that long then. 2 years later? So. So I joined these guys. And I just put a post out saying, I want to dress like a man or be a drag king or somebody, someone, hello. And everyone was like, yes, we need more drag kings. We haven't got any. So I was like, brilliant. So this is us, this is me sort of doing the makeup for the first time. Sort of, it's a visual diary, but it's a feeling. So so you can see the men and women. And then I was picked up for Gay Pride this year. And so I submitted a couple of pieces of artwork for an exhibition about drag. So I just brought these to life a little bit on canvas. So I got...
Sorry, can you go back to the last one? Swipe from right.
Yes. Yeah. Awesome. Thank you very much. So this is the runway. Yeah. That's probably me, drunk and, you know. And there is glitter. I used real glitter. okay, and... And this one, so I got to tell my story in the way that I do, which is through art, or one way. Thank you. Oh, I just discovered palette knives. I love them. So this is me, my first drag performance as Justin Broman. That's it. That's me with a beard. Okay, so I have another poem, which still I was still editing today, so I still consider a work in progress. But I feel like it sums everything up a lot for me. This is how I'm nervous. What? Okay. In this world of imposed conformity, within the natural laws of duality, if I were a he, I would want to be a she, and a flamboyant queen I would probably be. I'm only a king because I was denied to society's expectations, told to abide, to be a girl and go without power, then as a woman, be a delicate flower. So what of my depth and beauty within, my strength and power and positive grin? It's all disregarded for the sake of my skin and the form it takes, my true self in the bin. I am a person, I tell myself over. Can't anyone see? Oh. I guess I'll show ya. I am a person, now everyone recognize. I'm not only the sum of what's between my thighs. I was told what to like and what to be good at, and as a cute girl, didn't like to be looked at. I was given pink knickers and long lacy socks, but I wanted to climb trees and go jumping on rocks. What is this dress, this impractical thing? Give me dungarees, from the trees I will swing. They say, make more of an effort to make yourself pretty. It's such a waste. Why are you so gritty? Still there. So I don't fit this box. Is it me that is wrong? I'm not pink and frilly, but sometimes I'll wear a thong. But not this world of blush and caring what you're wearing. My skin and my clothes, they're for being lived in. So am I a man then, on the inside? I ask myself, confused in my mind. If I'm not a girl, does that make me a boy? Or simply a person, not being society's toy? And are we all really the same? Dual in our nature, each one with a flame? Half and half go in the melting pot to make rainbowed people. But most of us forgot. Society around us and the people we know enforce this made-up binary show. We are born naked and natural and true. The rest is made up. So fuck it. You do you. So let's be reminded we are who we are and expose our true nature, spread our lights far. And no one can tell you because only you know. So it's all our duties to make ourselves glow. It's our real selves. As our real selves, we have most to offer. And living a lie... Sorry. As our real selves, we have most to offer, and living a lie will only make us and the world suffer. You are who you are. Only you can tell that story. So please know the world is waiting to hear of your glory. Thank you. What happened?
I'm still going.
Oh, you are.
Yeah.
Still going. But this
yeah.
is not...
It's
this one. Well, this is me, not as a man or as a woman, just wearing my waistcoat and being super happy as a person. And so kind of what I've been doing lately is just sort of imagining myself. I sort of imagine myself a little bit as a man, because then I kind of felt like actually I could just be a person. And I started to realize that maybe the reason why I'm attracted to dressing like a man is so that I can just be who I feel I am as a person. I guess I had pictures, but I think that's it. So thank you very much. Do you have any questions? Can anyone ask me questions?
Cool.
Anybody?
Yes. Your artwork is beautiful.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I don't know how to answer that with responding to a question. But if I don't have a question about my story or anything? One?
Yes.
Yes. Yes. So is my penis.
Oh, no, give it to this guy over here.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Amazing. One more round of applause for Claire, Allured, please. Face conscience. Justin Broman. Thank you very much, guys. All right. Every week I prepare too much content. It's kind of fun to always do that. But it's all pretty cool stuff this time. So I think I'm going to make a choice. And what I'm going to do now... is Lara Hardie Stewart here by chance? Not yet. She'll be coming to show us a little bit of art moving soon. I think we have time for two more little segments here. And I think that what we'll talk about is a current debate that's going on about drag kids. And then we'll have a chance to have a Q&A with our panelists. When Lara comes, we'll get to see a little bit of her artwork. Does that all sound good to everybody? And then we're going to call it a night after that. Cool. And then we'll show off the haikus. Yeah, of course. Thank you. No, of course. Of course we will. Of course. Thank you. Thank you. Alrighty, guys. So this segment is called Drag Kids, Gender Performance or Child Abuse. Okay. So, this whole story starts out with a boy called Desmond. He was born Desmond Napole in 2007 in Brooklyn, New York. And he says that he's been out since day one. Since he was 5 years old, when he was 5 years old, he liked to play with toy trains, and he liked to play with maps, and he liked video games, and he would play with some Barbies. But then when he was 6 years old, after seeing an Elsa costume in a store, he began asking his parents for princess dresses, and he wanted to start taking ballet lessons. And really everything changed for him after this. He started to explore this part of his personality that he never had the opportunity to explore before. His parents went to a therapist, and they asked for advice on what to do, and the therapist advised just allow your child to express themselves however they want, right? So they did. If Desmond wanted dresses, they allowed him to dress up in any way. So these are just a couple pictures of Desmond dressing up in drag. So his drag name is Desmond in is Amazing. In 2014, he was featured in a Jinx Monsoon music video, and this is alongside RuPaul, who was his hero. He performed at Gay Pride in New York City in 2015. And to track the progress of his career as a drag performer, one of his mother's friends set up a Facebook page. And the name of the Facebook page was Desmond is Amazing. This is how he got his name. So it was when he saw this page name, he thought, oh gosh, that's really nice. I love that name. Yeah, I am Desmond is Amazing. He says that his inspirations are RuPaul, Andy Warhol, Keith Haring, and then a lot of 1970s disco performers and many different designers that he's taken the time to really study. He's launching a project called House of Amazing, which is a club that is designed specifically for drag kids. Now, this is a term that wasn't used before Desmond, but he's starting a club specifically for kids who want to start expressing themselves using drag. He said, this is the first and only drag house exclusively for drag kids who want to do amazing drag. In this performance space, no adults are allowed. So you drop off, I see a lot of wide eyes here. So you drop off your child in this performance space, and the children are allowed to do whatever they want. Desmond calls himself a drag kid, not a drag queen. He says drag queens are really for adults. Yeah, Dean. I don't have his date of birth in here. The last article that I read said that he was 9 years old, and
he's
I think
11.
He's 11 now. Awesome. Yeah, cool. Thank you. Thank you very much. Yeah. So he's 11. So he was born, in something like 2007. Yeah. So you can search online for the House of Drag, and you'll find they have a YouTube channel, they have an Instagram, but so far it doesn't seem like the actual house has been created yet. So he's working hard right now to get this project underway. He says that in his life, he would really like to have his own fashion line and his own cosmetic line. Any other questions about Desmond so far? No, all good. Okay, cool. A few more pictures. These are all lifted off of Desmond's Instagram. Here's Desmond and RuPaul. So Desmond says, people should be able to dance, sing, or dress in any way. You can express yourself however you want. It doesn't matter if you like jazz or rap, ballet or ballroom dresses or suits. You just do you. This was released a few weeks ago. Must have been more than a year ago. Says the opening of the House of Drag House of Amazing is going to be on the 19th of October, 2017. It seems like this hasn't actually happened yet so far. You can look it up on Instagram right now if you want to. Okay. So I'm not sure if anybody here is familiar with Ben Shapiro, but there is a pretty big divide right now. One hand coming up. Good. So there's a pretty big divide right now on opinions about allowing children to express themselves using drag performance. So Ben Shapiro says, pretty definitively, he says, this is child abuse. These are all quotes. I'm just going to read him directly. He's obviously prepubescent, so it's unlikely that he has any sexual feelings as of yet. to even question whether Mom and Dad have Desmond's best interests at heart by trotting him before cameras wearing adult female makeup and clothing is to be seen as intolerant these days. So he's saying to even question this action, to question whether or not what the parents are doing is right, that is considered to be intolerant. He says, Mom and Dad are doing something horrible. They're not guarding Desmond from the public. They're pushing him into it. And they're doing so in order to politicize his childhood, to turn him into an advocate for sexuality he knows nothing about. Any questions about Ben Shapiro's thoughts here? Yes, please.
What part of what he said do you disagree with?
What part of what he said do I personally? Sorry, one more time.
What part of the quotes do people disagree with?
I disagree with the fact that he knows nothing about sexuality because you know you are somehow from a very young age, 5, 6, 7, you know. And if you look at Desmond is amazing doing public appearances, he lives for these things. He lives for being a drag kid. It's not something that is forced because if something is forced on somebody, you can see it. You can only act to a certain degree. And I don't think an 11-year-old would have the patience to act every single time they're in front of the camera. So, yeah, whoever this Ben Shapiro is just looking for cheap publicity. And unfortunately, they're giving it to him because Desmond is amazing because he loves to do what he does at this young age.
Awesome, thank you. Maybe we can hear from one more person and then we'll move on. Yeah, please. Ben Shapiro. So Ben Shapiro is a public personality. He's considered a part of the growing right wing in the United States. So he's a United States pundit. Say it again. And he's Christian. He's Jewish. Okay, great. Thank you. Yeah. So you can just pass it right on to these guys. Yeah, please. I think you just have to turn on the microphone. Little switch in the front.
Can I add something?
Please.
So as we've already said, drag really has nothing to do with sexuality. Yes, the generalization is it's gay men dressing as women. But as we've seen tonight, we've got straight men, straight female, gay female, everything in between. Drag has nothing to do with sexuality. So his parents aren't forcing him to think he's a woman or think they're not forcing him to think he's a woman who likes men trapped in the wrong body. They're just helping him say drag is fun. It's gotten there. Ben Shapiro is saying they're forcing him in one direction in terms of sexuality, but drag isn't something that's limited to one sexuality, gender type, gender preference. So it's very narrow-minded in terms of what we're seeing tonight on the panel and doesn't really line up with what drag is and who can do drag, in my opinion.
I just want to add something. I think I might be a little bit of a different tone from the other people that spoke. I agree with what J.Lew just said, that drag isn't necessarily about sexuality. It's more about gender. And insofar as it's about gender and this kid's gender expression and him wanting to feel accepted for who he is, I think that's fine. But a lot of my experience in drag is, even if it's not overtly sexual, that sexuality is always something in the toolbox. And I think that getting a child involved that close to an area where adults could be so overtly sexual might be ill-advised. I think that the opportunity for miscommunication to happen is really, really high. So I don't necessarily disagree with it, but I think that it's incredibly risky. And I think that really, really great care should be taken any time that you get a minor involved in anything like this, where sexuality is just on the cusp of being involved anytime.
Let's hear one response on the nine, and then I'll move on to lactation. Yeah, please.
Only a question. Could this be...
Thank you. Yeah, I think it's on. I think it's on.
How does this differ from beauty pageants with 3 and 4 year old girls in it?
Yeah, I think, yeah, I...
Can I just say one thing? I mean, I don't know this guy, to be honest, but would he have the same concerns if Desmond was dressed up in hyper-masculine clothing and as a superhero, whatever you
given
define
toy
as
guns.
Hyper-masculine, would he have the same concerns? I don't think so.
Excellent. Yeah, thank you. Thank you, guys. Okay, so we'll move on to one more drag kid. Does anybody know Lactatia? Lactatia. So Lactatia was born Nemis Quinn Melancion Golden. Today, Lactatia's 8 years old, and he is a drag queen from Montreal. He's self-described as being an LGBTQ activist and advocate. He says, I've been getting into drag since I was 7. But literally, I've been into wearing dresses and been into girl stuff since I was 3. So his parents say, when Nemis is out of character, he identifies as a boy and in drag as a girl. Drag for Nemis is about the performance, the character. When he's Lactatia, becoming her character, he's a girl with a penis. So, does anybody know the drag performer Del Rio?
Hallelujah.
Yeah. So, Del Rio is a particularly vulgar drag performer, or at least this is the way that she's been described by many commentators. And during the Work the World tour in Montreal, Lactatia was invited up onto the stage. And there were some comments that were made to Lactatia that were really brought up in the media. So one of them, Del Rio jokes about buying him a shot of liquor at this time. She calls him a bitch. And she says, she asks Lactatia who her favorite drag queen is, expecting that Lactatia will say Del Rio. She doesn't. And she says... She says, even though I'm not your favorite, you're my fucking favorite. Yeah. So we can have our own opinions about what kind of language is appropriate in front of children. But this is something that definitely caused quite a storm online. Is this language, if this language is a part of the culture, if this shading, if this reading is a part of drag culture, is this something that we want to have around children is the question. So there are pro-family critics. Pro-family organizations tend to be Christian organizations that try to keep gay marriage illegal, saying that they're protecting the sanctity of the family. So pro-family critics say that Lactatia's parents and all adults who encourage him are guilty of child abuse. They say the parents of this little boy are celebrated for immersing him in a culture of adult perversion. This is unambiguous and shameful child abuse. Through the trans cult movement, evil is being promoted as good, and innocent women and children are the victims. This comes from Laurie Higgins, who's the cultural writer for the Illinois Family Institute. I like the laughter, that's good. Laurie Higgins says the drag queen world is about as far from a safe and secure environment as a child is able to get. That his parents are reckless, endangering the boy and guiding him into a destructive future filled with perversion. That these events are filled with catty people that are often sadomasochistic jokes slamming other queens. The Western world has surpassed Sodom in its evil. Thank you, Killian. That's good. Sounds like some of us are proud. All right. Any questions about this one? Okay.
Yes. Comment.
Yes, please.
I think more than anything, these critics are taking drag seriously. And if there's one thing about drag, it never, ever takes itself seriously. Mm.
Yeah.
Okay. Look at me. I look like a clown.
So there's a YouTuber called The Amazing Lucas. I don't think that the Amazing Lucas name comparison is intentional at all, but he was speaking about Desmond, and he recognized that Desmond, in an interview, said that he discovered RuPaul's Drag Race when he was 2. And on his YouTube channel, The Amazing Lucas, this YouTuber, he said, if they're referring to children, he's saying, if children are perceived in society as being adult enough to choose their own gender, if they're adult enough to start being a drag kid and explore these issues, well, I feel that the next step is for them to be adult enough to experience an actual adult relationship. That if they're allowed to explore these things, then they should be, logically, allowed to explore other kinds of relationships. And he says that this is setting up the groundwork for pedophilia. I'd love a response. Yeah, yeah. If there's something somebody wants to say, yeah, yeah.
I feel like this is the exact same slippery slope argument that you saw with the gay marriage debate that happened in the 2000s, which obviously it hasn't really amounted to anything. Is this working? Everybody can hear me? My parents allowed me to order off the adult menu at restaurants starting at around age 9. And at no point between that and I think age 27 was I ready for an adult relationship. So yeah, just speaking from my own experience.
Great. Thank you. Yes, please. Yeah. Oh, is there another question? Yeah, please.
So drag is fun and it's a performance, and we want people to be able to really explore how creative they are and how and follow their own passions from whatever age they are. And I mean, drag, yes, it has some edges to it that you know you can negotiate, but to assume that because you're exposing your kid to, not even exposing, I mean, this kid clearly likes it, right? That sounded really bad. But what I mean by that is that, like, if you look at where actual abuse comes from, it comes from repression. It doesn't come from being open. It doesn't come from being, I mean, you can look at statistics. I mean, you don't tend to have abuse from people who are able to express themselves from the time they're young. You tend to have abuse from people who were never able to express themselves.
Excellent. Thank you. Thank you.
I have something to
add. Yeah, please.
So a lot of these statements, I guess more going back to Ben Shapiro, kind of come from a place where they're assuming that there is no child-friendly space in drag. And in a lot of places, there are events that are all ages, and drag performances are catered towards a younger audience.
Great, thank you. So on the 15th of May, 2008, so just a couple of months ago, there was a photo that was shared on Instagram with Lactatia holding a balloon saying, "Eat a dick." Yeah. So this might be a very common insult that's thrown around in the drag community, and it's like they said, we're not taking it seriously. We're not taking these comments seriously, and the problem is that these people are taking these comments too seriously. The question that's being raised online, so the comments that were flooding this Twitter post, is that it's just not something that's appropriate for a child to be around. Maybe in the community, it's something that's understood to be a joke, but for a child who doesn't really understand what this phrase means, or maybe it's something that we think that a child maybe shouldn't understand what this phrase means, that maybe it's not appropriate to have a child in this community. You can look this up. If you look up eat a dick lactatia, I think that you'll find this on online. And you can read some more of the quotes, some more of the comments on Twitter. Yeah. Okay. All right. So we can now, with all of that, move into our next discussion. So the question is, should there be a minimum age to perform drag? Are there any subjects that are too mature for children? And is gender performance one of them? So we have about 10 minutes for this one, and then when we come back, we'll hear from Lara Hardie Stewart. She's prepared some art for us. And then we'll have a Q&A with the panelists, and then we'll call it a night. Thank you so much, guys. Thank you very much. Oh, and we're also going to do the haikus then. Jesus. All right, go for it, guys. Thank you. Alrighty, everybody. Thank you for holding on for just another extra second. Now, we're going to have a little participation from everybody in the audience. A little participation. I'm going to need your help. First of all, for the artists who provided us with images, for the artists who provided us with poetry, for the performers who put on a drag performance, and for our beautiful panel, can we please get one big round of applause for everyone who's helped us out tonight? Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you very much. I do quickly. So we have this haiku and drawing contest with the prompt, let your inner queen shine. And so we have three haikus and we have three drawings, and I need your help. We've narrowed them down to three. We got a lot of submissions. Thank you so much to everybody who put in a submission here. But we narrowed them down to three, and I need your help. And I'm sorry, I did this in a kind of rush to make it easier for us. So we're all going to have to tilt our heads a little bit to the side. So here is poem number one. Peering through the glass, mirror, mirror on the wall, you reflect my soul. Number two. Sorry. Shine, motherfucker. Shine. Because you can only shine when your queen is on. And number three. Shining rainbow bright, bring out the shimmer and heels. The queen is here, bitch. All right, so could I get a round of applause? And we're going to do this by the sound of the round of applause. So could I please get a round of applause for number one, peering through the glass. It's coming. Oh, no, what's happening? Come on. For number one, peering through the glass, round of applause. If this was anybody's favorite, please. Thank you. For number two, shine, motherfucker. And number three, the queen is here, bitch. All right, that sounds like a pretty clear winner. Whose haiku is this? Would anybody like to claim this one? Whose haiku? Ah, Al. Beautiful Al. All right. Chung, if you can get Al a drink of his choosing, please. Thank you very much. Yeah. Perfect. Yeah. Good. Thank you very much. And for the drawings, we have number one, purple hair. Number two, red dress, Jackson. And number three. I don't even know if we need to take a vote on that one, actually. Okay, we do. All right, so let's go back to number one. Number one. Round of applause for number one, please. Round of applause for number two, Jackson. And round of applause for number three. That's pretty clear. Whose was this? Would anybody like to stand up, crowd? Oh, beautiful. Thank you so much. So you can order whatever you want, and it's on up tonight. Thank you so much. Amazing, guys. So with all of that, I'd like to introduce Lara Hardie Stewart, who'd like to quickly tell us about a piece that she devised for us. So, Lara, come on up. The floor is yours. I'm just going to pull this up here. Yeah.
Hi, everyone. I'm Lara, and I did that thing. Not really to talk about the piece, but more talk about why drawing it.
I did psych in university, and I remember in my final year exam, one of my essay questions that was a big chunk of the mark was, what is your gender and why? And I was like, the fuck? And I sat there in the middle of this hall, and I had like an existential crisis for like a DP, for like a mark. And I sat there, and I was like, well, I guess I gotta answer this. Kind of like my life flashed before my eyes and all those things. And I thought about it, thought about why I never really cared about what my gender was. And I don't know if you maybe mentioned it, but Judith Butler, in the great wise words of Judith Butler, gender's performative. And always thought about that, about the dollhouse for the girl and the car for the boy and why that apparently made sense. My parents never gave a shit about that. They really didn't. I literally grew up in the desert. My parents didn't care. And I remember being like 9 and getting changed and realizing, reading the tag on my jeans, and they were for boys aged 8 to 9. And I was like, I went back to my cupboard. All of my jeans were boy 8 to 9. And I went back to my mom and I said, why are my jeans boy jeans? She said, because they fit better. And I was like, yeah. Yeah, they do. And they have pockets, which is great. And when I wrote that exam, that test, I mean, my sexuality, my sexual preference, my gender identity, it's all done the things. And I never really thought about it. It's hard to commit to how I want to show myself to the world and how I see myself. A lot of the time, it's just a lot of effort. And sometimes I feel I'm acting, dressing feminine. Am I a woman? I'm dressing, acting masculine. Am I really a man? Am I in the wrong body? All of those things. And why it changed every day. And then I realized it didn't have to be binary and it didn't have to be a thing. And it could just basically be whatever the hell I wanted it to be, even if that was a mixed match. So I drew this because it's confusing and arousing. And that's what gender and sexuality should be. So, yeah, that's it.
Amazing, awesome, thank you. Thank you so much, Lara. So the Hanoi Philosophy Forum is gonna be starting a zine relatively soon, and Lara's actually offered to take up this project, starting a zine for all of us, with all of the materials and the haikus and the drawings and the content that we were creating. So, but if anybody's interested in helping Lara with this zine, please do contact her. I think it's gonna be a really, really cool project, all right, guys, so I'm sorry. It's 10:24 right now. This is scheduled to go until 10. If anybody needs to go because it's past your bedtime, we understand. But I think there's something very cool that's about to come up. So now it's a time to have a Q&A with our panelists here. I'd love for you guys to stick around. Could I get one round of applause for our panelists here tonight? Thank you so much for sticking around with us, guys. Thank you. So what I'll do, it's a little late now. I think we have a time for about 15 minutes. How does that sound? Yeah, and then if you tell me that we want to go longer, maybe we can go longer. But I'll really just open it up to the floor. Does anybody have any questions for any of our panelists? Everybody's always so shy to be the first person. Yes, please. Yeah, Lara.
How old were you when you first realized that more than just a joke or just for fun, dressing as the different gender was something that really resonated with you and it was something that was really important?
I did a whole lot of theater in high school and I realized very early on that if you really wanted to get a cheap laugh, you could just put a guy in a dress and everyone would laugh at it. And there was something in my brain that I never quite understood. I totally got into it. I would, any time that I had an opportunity, would put on a dress and people would just laugh and laugh and laugh. And I would also get a lot of, like, kind of side stares. And a lot of my friends who had been friends for a long time would be really uneasy with it. But any time that I prompted them and I was like, you know, why is this so weird? Like, why is it uncomfortable to you? No one could ever give me an answer. And the way my personality is, I mean, there's nothing really artistic or academic about this. It just kind of turned into me wanting to fuck with all of them. And so I did. And that was kind of the start for me. It's that no one could give me an answer as to why me putting on a dress was so, like, weird or uncomfortable for them. And so I just kept doing it until they'd give me an answer, and nobody gave me an answer. So here I am now, 10 years later.
I think for me, more than anything, is about visibility, especially because of our trans brothers and sisters out there. It's very important for us to blur the lines in terms of gender expression and gender identity, because the next generation needs to be beyond this cultural revolution. It should just be a cultural norm more than anything. So I did drag for the first time at 19, and I was very busted. So I decided that I'm going to stop, because I don't like looking like a busted queen, you know. But we know that there are many transgender men and women who cannot afford the surgeries, the boobs, not even the makeup, you know. So they go out on the streets with a beard and a peplum dress and stuff like that, and they get harassed. So it's important for us to be visible for them more than anything else.
To answer your question, I have a very short story. When my mother was pregnant with me, she almost had a miscarriage, so she had to lie on her back for about 10 weeks. She spent the entire time hand-making these little smocks, like little embroidery, just imagining about her little girl coming out. And she tells me, always tells me, that when I came out, I refused to wear them and would only wear dungarees. So from in the womb, I was already rebelling.
Could I get any question from anybody else in the audience? Yeah, please, please, please.
So correct me if I'm wrong, but people who take that step out of the norm and do performance art and things like that are often viewed as independent and, you know, fuck the world, I'm going to do whatever I want to do. But that being said, can you talk a little bit about what the community of drag is? Like, is that a strengthening thing, is there a separation between I'm independent and I'm going to do what I want and the drag community, or do they blend to the point where you kind of need it? Does that question make sense?
Can you rephrase?
Yeah. How important is the drag community for you as a person, even though you're expressing your own individuality?
I can say something. I've literally just joined. And so for me, yeah, it's always been a thing that I wanted to just wear practical clothing. And and it's always, yeah, something that I sort of always felt has been rejected in all different ways. I just suddenly put a post out, and I was like, I want to do this. And everyone's like, yes, you do you. And I'm like, can I do this? Do whatever you want. And I'm so happy, because it's like the opposite of what was before. I was like, oh, here I am in opposite land, and I love it. So that's my experience.
You guys can correct me if I'm wrong on anything, but this may be elementary for some people, but what's very common in drag is to have houses or families where there would be a drag mother. So for some people, this is very important. For example, for Winnie, she is part of a drag family or a drag house called Victim. They have a mother who, you can correct, of course, who instructs them in the way of makeup, in the way of performance, gives them challenges, and so on. The rest of us, we're not part of a family. We don't have a drag mother per se. We call ourselves the drag orphanage because we don't have a mother, so we're just together. But in saying that, we do rely on each other a lot. In terms of the very basic things, where the fuck do you buy tights in Hanoi? Or like, where do I get makeup from? Or does this look good on me? Does it look shit? So yes, there is a lot of community in drag. I can only speak to the drag community in Hanoi because that's what I know. But yes, there is a definite sense of community. Even though the houses or families may be separate, there is a community for sure.
Great. Thank you. Thank you. Yeah, you had a question, please.
Question. Who is your biggest drag influence and why? Choices, Henny.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Oh, I think Winnie Wakanda, Washington. Anyone else?
It's very hard to choose one. Yeah. Top two, probably Violet Chachki or Kimchi, I would say, for me personally.
I don't exactly have a drag inspiration, but most of what I go off of is actually Weird Al Yankovic for my performance style. Everything that I kind of do, I kind of try and think of it in the way that Weird Al would think of it. All of my performances, I try and misinterpret a song in some strange way, in a way that I hope is funny and I think has been funny as many as one whole time. It's Weird Al.
Specifically bio queens, if you want to look up some. My two favorite bio queens are Victoria Sin and, I'm drawing a blank.
Vicky DeVille?
Yeah, Vicky DeVille, sorry. Right.
Excellent. Yep.
Not a drag person, but I love Annie Lennox. She's so fierce and androgynous. Oh my God.
Great. I think we have time for one or two more from the audience. We'll go to Alex. Yeah.
Hi. My question is, how much is that drag persona that you do? How much is it a different persona than your regular self without the makeup, without the costume? Is there like a different persona, or is it, do they blend? Do they intertwine? I reckon it's different for everyone, so I'm curious to hear.
I'm still totally working that out. At first, I thought it was weird. I was like, I don't want another persona. And then I was like, oh, maybe it kind of gives me an opportunity. And it just turns out my persona is just more shy than me. So still working on that part.
I've 5 different personas, so I feel like they're necessarily all different from me. They're all kind of different parts of my personality that I just exaggerate and then pepper with other people that I've known.
But to the best of my ability, I try my best not to be myself whenever I'm in drag the whole time.
They're all more fun than Blake.
Well, I was initially very insecure with myself before doing drag. Thank you. I was initially very insecure because I don't know if many of you know here, but race is a big determining factor for many things in the world. If you're not a heterosexual male dude, life can be really hard for you. So Winnie came from Winnie Mandela, who really took up the armed struggle in South Africa. The women of Wakanda, you watch Black Panther and you see those women who are a part of the army. Which movie do you see where each and every member of the army is a woman? It's rare. And Washington came from Kerry Washington because before Scandal, there had been a 42-year gap for a female to lead a TV series. And Olivia Pope is a badass, you know? So for me, creating Winnie Wakanda Washington was a way for me to transcend all my insecurities about being gay, about being black, about being a feminine person in real life. So, yeah.
Alrighty, everybody. Well, unless somebody has one more really burning question, I think that's where we'll leave it. I saw one hand shot up, so yeah, let's take one more. Then we're going to call it a night. Thank you very much. Yeah, please.
Yes, most important question of the night. Is it gay to like a drag queen if you are a man?
I need to clarify. Yes.
Only if you want it to be.
I'm straight, by the way. Not that it matters, but Zaza confuses me. Like a lot.
I mean, I need to clarify your question. You like drag queens or do you like androgynous people?
I'm not saying what I like, I'm just saying hypothetically.
Okay, I mean, I really don't prefer it for people to come and approach me sexually as a drag queen because I don't have sex looking like this. Yeah. You know, you can imagine how the sheets are going to look like when I finish. You know, so yeah, please approach me when I look normal and not like this.
So I've only been doing drag for like 7 months, and the fourth or the fifth time, and there were like 3 straight guys hitting up on me, and then we made out in a club. So it's like, for me, that's like, I don't know about me, but if they believe what they see, and if they like what they see, they're gonna go for it regardless of what you look like or how you look like. They're just gonna go for it. I mean, I look like this, so there's nothing else I can say more. So that's just who I am in this form. So, yeah.
And did you like it that the straight men were hitting on did you roast about it?
69% of the time.
Yeah.
Amazing. And with all of that, can I please get one big round of applause for our panel, please? Thank you. Thank you so much for being here tonight, guys. Thank you so much for being here. In addition to our panel, there are a lot of people to thank, specifically to Winnie for putting on such a phenomenal performance for us. Thank you so much, Winnie. Thank you so much. Thank you to Claire, to Josh Roxas, who made this beautiful portrait here. We were planning on Skyping with Josh. We just ran out of time tonight. If anybody is a friend of Josh Roxas, maybe you could come on up and I'll take a little video of you and you could just say hi to him. And he said that he would kind of like that. Thank you to Lara Hardie Stewart for her artwork, to Truitt for handling the haiku and drawing contest, for Nosh for the music. He had to leave a bit early. Meghan Cook for doing such a great job on the research. Thank you so much, Meghan. Andrew Farang and to Nguyen for videography and photography, to Killian Blay for handling the audio and video setup for us tonight, Andy Foster and Alex Zielinski for just miscellaneous work all over the place. My name is John. If you don't know me, come on up and say hi. I love you guys, and I'm really thankful that I have the opportunity to do this with you every week. Good night.